Good evening, everyone. We are privileged to have Dr. Sahej Jamil, CEO of Welcome Trust DBT India Alliance, with us today for the Foundation Day lecture. To start with, I will request Dr. Amjad to give a bouquet to Professor Dr. Jamil. He was a PhD student of Dr. Jamil. Thank you, Amjad. May I request our Deputy Director, Professor Saptarishi, to introduce today's guest.
Good evening, everyone. It's a privilege to have Dr. Sahej Jamil as our Foundation Day lecturer. So just a brief introduction. Dr. Jamil is presently the Chief Executive Officer of the Welcome Trust DBT India Alliance. He did his BSc from Aligarh Muslim University and MSc from the IIT Kanpur. Subsequently, he did his PhD in biochemistry from the Washington State University and after his postdoctoral research from the University of Colorado Health Sciences Center, in 1987 he joined as an assistant professor in the Division of Rheumatology, Department of Medicine, University of Colorado. Then after 1 year he came back to India. And in 1988, Dr. Jamil established the virology group at the International Center for Genetic Engineering and Biotechnology, New Delhi, and headed it for the next 25 years. His research and training program in human viruses led to many highly cited publications and awards and accolades. Just to name a few, he is fellow of all the National Academy of Sciences. He has been a recipient of the Shanti Sarup Bhatnagar Award in the year 2000. He is a recipient of the B.M. Birla Science Prize in Biology and he is an elected member of the Guha Research Conference. Dr. Jamil has been very active in science policy and administration for the last two decades. In 2013, he was appointed as the CEO of the Welcome Trust DBT Alliance, a co-founded partnership between the Welcome Trust UK and the Department of Biotechnology, Government of India. He has tirelessly promoted India Alliance through outreach events and raised his visibility through public engagement and activities. He has helped in setting up India Research Management Initiative to improve institutional research ecosystems and the India Science Media Fellowships to strengthen the reporting in science in mainstream India media. Under his leadership, India Alliance has scaled new heights for the excellence of its supported research and administrative processes. So with these words, I welcome Dr. Jamil to kindly deliver his address.
Well, thank you very much for having me over and thank you everyone for coming at the end of the day, 5 p.m. Not an easy thing to do, despite the chai and samosas out there. I'm sorry, I don't know whether there were samosas out there or not. But anyway, thank you to the director, deputy director, faculty, staff, and students of ICER, Bhopal, for inviting me. Please accept my congratulations on and best wishes on your 13th Foundation Day. Though not yet a teenager, ICER Bhopal has much to be proud of. You have hired capable faculty, built infrastructure in this short period of time, and I believe that will serve you well in the times to come. And I'm sure that will also help you provide high quality science education to the next generation. Where I currently sit, I have a ringside view of at least biological sciences at ICER Bhopal. And I can say this with confidence that you have extremely competitive young faculty. Our own fellowship program is very competitive, and we fund at a rate of about 10%. And you have four of our fellows in your biological sciences department here at ICER Bhopal. So that tells me that you really hire very competitive faculty. And I'm sure this would be true for other departments also. Nurtured well, these young faculty are going to make you even prouder in the days to come. So today I would attempt to look at higher education in India. I'll say very little about science per se, but attack the problem of higher education in a more general way. We face serious challenges as we aspire to become a knowledge and innovation economy. So let me start by first asking, what is a university? India's first Prime Minister, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, said, a university stands for humanism, for tolerance, for reason, for progress, for the adventure of ideas, and for the search of truth. It stands for the onward march of the human race towards even higher objectives. He also said that a vast responsibility rests on our universities and educational institutions and those who guide their destinies. Allow me to also quote Maulana Azad, who was India's first education minister. And he said that educationists should build the capacities of the spirit of inquiry, creativity, entrepreneurial and moral leadership among students and become their role model. While you at this ICER and other ICERs may be lucky, your brethren at most Indian institutions of higher education are exposed to suboptimal leadership whose sole purpose is to remain in power and use the institution for personal glory. So I ask, therefore, how can the university turn the dreams of our forefathers into reality? Education is both a private and public good. It provides personal gains through employment. It is also a public good because it allows the state to obtain returns through taxation and creates more engaged, enlightened, and responsible citizens. Education builds a reflective mind that discovers from books, dialogues, engagement, and experiences. In the book, Building Universities That Matter, Pankaj Chandra, who is currently the Vice Chancellor of Ahmedabad University and is a former director of IIM Bangalore, he says that universities are places of social development that inspire and provoke, question and answer, build beliefs and destroy myths, that delve into the depths of the past and rise into the heights of the future, that debate the metaphysics of extension of existence, yet create models to decode the mind. The university represents a way of life. This way of life is in trouble in our country. India assumed that with liberalization of its economy, only government processes and market forces would sustain the economy. But markets require innovation, and governments require citizens that build social values around them. If the filing of patents is a benchmark innovation, consider that in 2016, India as a country filed less than 5% of patents that were filed by China in the same year. And the numbers are 45,000 for India, 1.1 million for China. As for social values, I'm sure you have seen how educated people throw garbage on the streets and do even nastier things on the streets in public view. These are all indicators of a faulty education. The purpose of a university goes beyond the narrow idea of preparing one for employment. Its broader purpose is to prepare the youth to meet the challenges of life, of which earning a livelihood is one. And with the nature of work changing itself, far faster than ever before, these are significant challenges. Thus, it is even more important that our universities teach young people to think, to innovate, and to solve problems. If you ask whether Indian universities are doing this, the answer is mostly in the negative. So the question is, why have we reached this situation? So for that, let us look at the growth of higher education in India. In 1950-51, there were 27 universities, 578 colleges, and only 0.2 million students in higher education. By 2018-19, this number rose to 993 universities, almost 40,000 colleges, and about 37.5 million students. The gross enrollment ratio, which is the percent of 18 to 23 year olds who are enrolled in a college or university, was about 24% in 2013. And last year it has risen to 26.3%. The target is to reach a ratio of about 30% by 2022. So consider that to reach a ratio of 50%, one would have to create twice as many universities and colleges as you have today. And that's a big challenge. Higher education in India has expanded quickly, and it has expanded quickly to meet the demands of nation building and the aspirations of a young population. Rapid expansion rarely maintains the quality of faculty, teaching programs, research infrastructure, processes, etc., and creates a situation that is not good towards the same young population that you're trying to help and educate. India has the world's third largest higher education system after US and China. But there is not a single Indian institution that is in the top 100 in the world. Sadly, we have responded to this situation by suggesting that global metrics are biased, and therefore we must have our own metrics. That, unfortunately, is not a solution. World-class institutions, for their development and sustenance, have three requirements: autonomy, leadership, and funds. Let us visit each of these and see how they are connected. The 19th and 20th and early 20th centuries saw the establishment of many prominent colleges and universities in India. I can give you examples of the university that I studied as an undergraduate, Aligarh Muslim University. Then there is Banaras Hindu University, there is MS University Baroda, Mysore University, St. Stephen's College, Hindu College, Presidency College. Many of these institutions were set up in this period. But the important thing is that it was private donations that played a prominent role in their establishment. And they retained both transparent as well as flexible governance till the 1950s, when the government of India decided to provide grants to higher education institutions and created something called the University Grants Commission, or UGC. This really started the era of state control, or what some of us call as the Sarkarikaran of higher education. Last year, the Government of India announced its intent to repeal the UGC Act of 1956 and replace UGC with something called the Higher Education Commission of India, or HECI. Would HECI return this lost autonomy to universities? At least that's the promise. Is it good or bad? What might it do to the funding model of universities? But first, let us understand what is autonomy. Quoting Pankaj Chandra again, autonomy allows for simplification of rules, creates local models that work for the institution, and builds a community that makes its own choices and is held accountable for those choices. Autonomy enables well-prepared institutions and well-intentioned institutions to soar higher. The objective should be to standardize outcomes by using variable inputs and variable processes, which are also relevant to the context. In any institution of higher learning, everyone who enters this institution, either as a student or as a faculty, is not alike. People are different, and therefore the system should have a way of understanding this diversity and respecting this diversity and nurturing this diversity. Unfortunately, UGC forced Indian universities to do exactly the opposite: standardize the structures and processes without caring for the output. And this has led to uniform thinking, low experimentation, and reduced tolerance for diversity. I remember my time as a student at AMU as well as IIT Kanpur. My friends and hostel mates were students of different faculties and departments. This diversity created an understanding that increased tolerance and solved many problems locally. Today, at large multicultural and multi-specialty universities, they prefer administrative control over diversity. The hostels accommodate students according to faculty. The provost and the wardens are also members of the same faculty. This is a short-term governance measure, and this does not support an open thinking and innovating culture of a university. The next issue is that of faculty hiring and assessments, which are possibly the most important thing for a vibrant higher education institution. And unfortunately, both are faulty at most Indian institutions. Hiring is standardized for fear of litigation and is recommended by external experts who have no knowledge of the culture or needs of the department, the faculty, or the university. There is no system of mentoring young faculty with advice on teaching, research, as well as institutional culture. There is also no periodic assessment, which is linked to a reward system. The personal promotion scheme ensures that given enough time, everyone will be promoted irrespective of whether they know how to teach or do research. I also look back at the institutions that I have attended in the West and see how faculty are hired and assessed. It is the colleagues who do it, and it works because there is trust in the system. And I believe the same thing happens at IITs and ICERs, so you can consider yourself to be the lucky ones. But at most universities, that is not the case. Academic freedom and autonomy, excellence and meritocracy, academic conversations and a strong respect for peer review define a culture. Many of these are missing from our universities. People spend most of their time discussing other people instead of discussing ideas. The second important thing is leadership. Peter Drucker, who was an important management person, said something very interesting. He said only three things happen naturally in organizations: friction, confusion, and underperformance. Everything else requires leadership. In India, governments often send the wrong signals by frequently appointing heads of institutions who distinguish themselves not in academic pursuits, but in their political patronage. As a result, most Indian institutions do not follow the democratic traditions of debate and consensus building, which are the hallmarks of higher education. The better ones do, but most don't do it. Shared governance is never about majority or minority views. It is about protecting shared beliefs and the process of decision making. It is about influencing decisions not by how loud you can shout, but through intelligent and rational arguments. The stakeholders should only be driven by the central theme of a university. And the central theme of a university is to improve learning opportunities for students. That's all that matters. Institutions themselves are complex in their governance and multidimensional in their aspirations and activities. They require clarity in leadership and effective decision making. The vice chancellor or the director of an institution is not the only source of wisdom on campus. The governance structure at most institutions is hierarchical instead of being flat. With their appointment, institution heads suddenly become the wisest people on campus, and many start looking up to them for advice on even most trivial matters. More worrying is that they also start taking themselves very seriously, develop egos, and consult only those who agree with their point of view and do not listen to conflicting opinions. There is hardly a counter view that is heard in academic and executive councils of universities. And this way of working percolates down to departments, to research labs, to administrative offices, which unfortunately leads to personal agendas, a mistrust of each other, and petty competition. The key to managing a university effectively lies in recognizing it as an organization. And leadership is possibly the most significant aspect of organizational governance. Vision, courage, and the ability to execute decisions are key attributes of a leader. A good leader understands the evolving environment and transforms the organization to meet its goals. This change making is about courage, believing in something, and building a consensus to implement something new. Leaders tend to concentrate decision-making powers only when they fear that their ideas would find strong opposition. Those without courage find it convenient to hide behind rules. Who is a leader accountable to? In the context of a university, the over-regulation of our universities has ensured that the Vice Chancellor is accountable to the University Grants Commission, to the Ministry of HRD, and to the political class. But if the university is an organization, it should follow the rules of organizational governance, and accountability should apply. The Executive Council is to a university as the board is to an organization or a corporation. But instead of having an independent chair of the board, the Executive Council is chaired by the Vice Chancellor. This is a clear conflict of interest, and therefore things don't work the way they should be working. I have been a member of two of the highest decision-making bodies at my alma mater, AMU, the Executive Council and the court. And I can safely say that a lot of energy is generated in those rooms. Unfortunately, most of it is heat and very little light. Let me say a few words on future leadership. There are a lot of young people in the audience, and I hope they will pay attention to this, that the skills we must teach our young people are important. I would refer to Farid Zakaria and his book, which is called In Defense of a Liberal Education, in which he lists the following as key action points. Think globally and follow your intellectual curiosity. Have cross-cultural appreciation and cultivate unfamiliar ideas. Of course, be tech savvy, which I'm sure most of you are, but also pay attention to good writing. You should be able to communicate your ideas well if you are going to be leaders of the future. And you should build alliances and partnerships, because the future belongs to people who will work in teams and not as individuals. Let us now look at the third aspect of higher education, which is funding. At a typical university in India, 85 to 90% of its annual budget is spent on salaries and pensions. There is very little left to do development work. The expenditure on higher education in India has seriously lagged behind the growth in enrollment. And if you see the graph on the left, the orange bar shows you the rate of growth of enrollment, and the red bar shows you the rate of growth of funding. And you can see that there is clearly a big difference. Over the past decade, public funding of higher education has stayed around 1.2% of GDP, which is shown on the table on the right. And these are from a report in 2019 by Brookings India, which is called Reviving Higher Education in India. It's online, you can go and look at it. The spending on research and development is no better. It has actually fallen from 0.8% to 0.7% of GDP during the same time that China raised it from 1.5% to 2.5% of their GDP. And you very well know that China's GDP is much higher than our GDP. So in absolute numbers, the amounts are much higher. There's low spending on R&D, and low numbers of researchers. The graph on the right shows the number of researchers in India per million population. So low spending on R&D and low numbers of researchers ensure that we are far from being a knowledge and innovation economy. How much should a country spend per student? In 2013, US universities spent about $11,000 per student per year. In the same year, India spent about $700 on an average per student per year. But the big difference is that in US, even a state university gets only about 25% of its funding from the state. The rest it raises itself through endowments and tuition fees and everything. In India, almost 100% of the funding for higher education comes from the state. And this is likely to change. If the Higher Education Commission comes into force, to wonder if grants to universities would be protected. Yes, they are willing to give you more autonomy, but autonomy will come at a cost. So, if tomorrow MHRD tells a university, a large central university, that I'm going to give you only 90% of your budget, you raise 10% of your budget, it would simply mean that they will only have money to pay salaries and nothing else, and that all development work will stop. The India Economic Survey 2017 also recognizes that India underspends on R&D, and the doubling of this expenditure is necessary. So we should be going from about 0.7% to about 1.5%. But the same economic survey also says that much of this increase should come from the private sector and from universities. Now I wonder where universities would get those funds. We are really not prepared for it. So therefore, universities in India must start identifying non-government sources of revenue. The growth of philanthropy in India is one potential source. The Corporate Social Responsibility Act, or the CSR Act, requires all companies with a turnover of 1,000 crores or more to support social causes by giving away 2% of their net profits. This could be a source of funding. Private philanthropy in India also has grown from about 6,000 crores in 2011 to 40,000 crores in 2014 and 70,000 crores in 2018. About half of this private philanthropy goes into the education sector, but hardly any goes into higher education. If the university is a social organization, if the university provides a public good, if it provides a social good, then it is also a rightful claimant for these sorts of funding. Surveys also show that about 50% of Indian donors, people who are called high net worth individuals, or about 50% of them do not know of enough credible organizations to spread their donations. About 60% of these donors say that they would increase their contributions if the beneficiary organizations displayed more transparency and accountability. For higher education institutions, this is both an opportunity and a challenge. Our universities would have to improve their governance and develop the ability to pitch their capacity, capability, and ideas to an audience which is fundamentally different from the taxpayer that currently supports your university. Besides annual reports that every institution brings out, which only recount the achievements and events that happened during the year, institutions must also occasionally produce a third-party impact assessment report and vision documents. Because the kind of people that you would be pitching to, they are going to only give if they think it's a worthy cause to give, and if they understand your language. That's very important. So the language is important, and for people with little technical understanding of what you do. And therefore, I again submit that for leaders of tomorrow, communications is going to be a key challenge. And all of you young people here, you should build your ability to communicate better while you still have the chance to do that. If there is one thing you can do to help yourself, learn to communicate better. Finally, ISER Bhopal, being a science-centric institution, let me address two questions that are asked quite frequently. What should we work on? Should we do basic science? Should we do translational science? Should we do implementation science, applied science, this science, that science? There is only good science and bad science. There's nothing else. So without worrying too much about that, we should try to create a culture for first-rate science. A culture where people are tackling important problems. And you know this very well, that we have no dearth of problems to study. Problems such as crop improvement to increase food production, understand nutrition, antimicrobial resistance, pest control, biodiversity, environmental degradation, non-communicable diseases, and these are just a few to name. I'm sure you can think of zillions of others. The second question that is often asked is, when would India get a Nobel Prize? And this, again, you know, policymakers love asking this question. But we've given you so much money, when will India get its Nobel Prize? The press also asks this to scientists, when would India get a Nobel Prize? So here I would quote Venki Ramakrishnan, who I'm sure you all know and I don't have to introduce. Venki said that Nobel Prizes are a byproduct of good science. They are not the goal of good science. They are just a byproduct of good science. If India gets a Nobel Prize in science in the next few years, it doesn't mean suddenly that Indian science has become great. It just means that one person happens to really beat the odds and do very well, like Sir C.V. Raman. However, if India wins 15 or 20 Nobel Prizes, then that would be a different story. So, instead of asking this question, when would India get a Nobel Prize? Nobel Prize is like Mount Everest, right? But Mount Everest doesn't stand in isolation. Mount Everest is part of a range of mountains. And unless there is a range, there is no Mount Everest. So let us work to building that range and not worry about that Mount Everest. It will happen by itself. Let me finally end by quoting Dr. Homi Bhabha. Bhabha said that, I feel that we in India are apt to believe that good scientific institution can be established by government decree or order. A scientific institution, be it a laboratory or an academy, has to be grown with care like a tree. Its growth in terms of quality and achievement can only be accelerated to a limited extent. This is a field in which a large number of mediocre or second-rate workers cannot make up for a few outstanding ones. And the few outstanding ones always take at least 10 to 15 years to grow. So now, the challenge to you at ICER, which is celebrating its 13th Foundation Day, is you're coming very close to that 10 to 15 years that Bhabha had predicted in 1963. And I do hope that you will rise to greatness and do us all proud. I must thank you again for inviting me to give this Foundation Day lecture. Thank you very much.
You talk about the private sector that actually invests in the research sector and something. So talking about the difference between the government initiatives and the private sector that
I can't hear you very well.
Hello. So you talk about the investments of private sector in the research programs. So if you can talk about this difference between the government initiatives and the private sector that actually talks about the quality control of the research project. Like government doesn't care about the quality control, but if you have a private sector that actually invests for your lecture, for your research program, then it will look on the quality control. What is the main difference in that case?
I understood private sector and I understood quality control. Well, to the private sector, quality is important. If that is what you're asking. To the taxpayer who doesn't ask you any questions, we've all used to the taxpayer funding us, not asking any questions. And we scientists sit in our ivory towers and say that, the common man won't understand what I do. What I do is so important that the common man won't understand. That's our problem. We need to develop those skills to communicate to the common man, the taxpayer, why he is supporting you and what have you done with that money. Scientists are generally poor communicators. But to all you young students, I would say, if you are into research and if you can explain your research to your grandmother, you're doing well. Practice that. So coming back to quality, yes, the private sector will require quality. And we must give up this chalta hai attitude and focus on quality. There is no doubt about that.
Yeah, another question, you talk about the warden system in different, hostels, like there is a like administrative autonomy happens in several institutions. So what about that if an institute actually put their students in a full 100% autonomy, rather talking to them and discuss their problems?
You'll have to say again, I didn't get your question.
If an institute puts 100% autonomy or decisions on the students itself, like they are the
autonomy
community members.
For students.
Yeah.
So what will then happen? Like,
he's asking about what if autonomy is given to the students.
What sort of autonomy?
No, if autonomy is given to the students, what are its consequences?
Well, one would assume that if you've come into higher education, you've come with a certain sense of maturity and you've come to learn. I'm actually talking to the converted. You're here because you've competed at a very high level and that's why you're here. That's not the case with most people in higher education in the country. I think autonomy has to be taken responsibly. If the institution gives you autonomy, then it also expects you to behave responsibly. So it cuts both ways. It cannot be a one-way street. No.
So any other questions?
Hello sir, this is a wonderful talk and I appreciate it for all of your views and it really matters to us to think more along these lines. I have spent the last one decade in this academic sector. I am faculty at BITS-Pilani in Hyderabad. So we face a different kind of problem. So regarding quality, this question comes up to our mind as well. So being a private sector employee, we are not in a centralized institution. We have some other problem as well. I think some of our colleagues in our central universities also face this issue. this is from the coming from the owners of the students. So the students are paying a lot when they come to our institute. So suppose I am aware that the student's quality is not enough to pass an exam or to cross a hurdle along the evaluation procedure. But in certain cases, I am forced actually to make that thing happen. Given the fact the student has paid a huge amount of money to come to the institute and he or she expects that she or he will go through easily and ultimately land a good job, essentially. So sometimes I see my colleagues saying that the quality control is not in your hand, you pass a student. The person who is hiring the student, the quality control lies on them, whether he or she wants to hire the student. So how will you justify this contradictory situation?
Well, any student who comes to institutions like BITS or IITs or ICERS has, you know, competed at a very high level to be there. I mean, it's not easy to get into BITS, right? So the question I would ask is, why is the student not doing well? Is it because he or she has no interest in the subject that is being taught? Is it because, you know, the student doesn't see that as a future for himself or herself? Why is that? And I'm sure that a student is good in something. I'll tell you an anecdote. I was at IIT Kanpur reviewing their Department of Biological Sciences and Bioengineering. I was part of a committee. They had a 5-year departmental review. And we met with students, undergraduate, PhD, we met with faculty. So the undergraduate student meeting was the most revealing. There was a room full of about 50 odd students. So one of us asked, how many of you are going to continue in this field when you graduate? Maybe 2 hands went up. So the next obvious question was, what will the rest of you do? And most people said that, you know, they're taking social science courses, they're taking management courses, and, you know, they will go into banks or they will go into development organizations. So the next question was, then why are you here? And one student got up and said, well, I mean, I really wanted to be in computer science, but my rank was not good enough to be in computer science. So here I am in biological sciences and biotechnology and bioengineering. That's all my rank could get me. But my parents insisted that I go to IIT Kanpur. So, you know, for the young people today, that is a big challenge. Parental pressure is tremendous. I never faced that parental challenge. People of my age did not. So I think we have to also very critically look at what we are doing to our young, both at home as well as in institutions where they come after competing at a very high level. And we have to develop an empathy and make sure that we find where their niche lies. Maybe this student who's failing your class is brilliant in doing something else. But unfortunately, and that is what I was talking about, variable input, standard outcome. We are looking at standard input, which leads to variable outcomes. So our higher education system really needs to look at some of these issues, and people who run these institutions need to look at these issues carefully. Absolutely. But absolutely, absolutely. The plumber and electrician that who comes to our homes does not get the same kind of respect that, you know, an IITian or a college professor who comes to our home, right? That's a fact of life here. Go to US,
a plumber or an electrician makes the same amount of money as a college professor. So it's a complex problem. You can't really, there are many issues here. Yes, I mean, no one wants to go to higher education just for the heck of it. They go there because society forces them to go, right? And, you know, a large part of our workforce does what I call PhD by default. They do an undergraduate degree, फिर क्या करें? Job नहीं मिल रही है. Masters कर लेते हैं. Masters कर लिया, you know, you are a decent student, you qualify the JRF. The amount of money you get as a JRF, you can't get a job for that much money. That's the reality of life. So it's complex. My plea to you as a teacher and to many others is, if you come across such a student, show some empathy and try to learn why they didn't do well in your course and whether they're doing well elsewhere. And maybe their niche lies elsewhere.
Thank you, sir, for a,
yeah, I can
for a very excellent talk. I have two questions. Also, a comment first that we have recently the document for the endowment fund at ISER Bhopal has been approved, and we'll be actively seeking funds from the philanthropists. But when it comes to the funding from those sources, if you look at the record in United States, the Carnegies and Rockefeller, Ford, they have literally like developed universities.
Sure.
But when it comes to India, we do see only one or two names, and then they are also very confident in terms of putting their money into Indian institutions. So why is that? Number one.
Oh, very easy. We like to leave money to our children. We don't like to leave money to public institutions. That's how we are.
They're still donating to universities in West. Maybe they see more confidence of branding there. That might be the reason.
And well, I mean, people have started donating in India. When I quoted these figures, I quoted from something called the India Philanthropy Report. It comes out every year. And if you look at the way private funding has grown in India, 6,000 crores in 2011, to 70,000 crores in 2018, you know, that's serious money. And this is not coming from, you know, your Tatas and Bildas only. This is coming from people in their 40s and 50s who have made money in the stock market, who have made money in the technology sector, who have made money in pharma, and they are donating to a cause. India, by the way, ranks very high in terms of private donations compared to our GDP. We do like to give, but most of the time we give to our mandirs and dargahs and churches. We don't give to universities and colleges.
And my second question was on innovation. So there are a couple of schemes and grants which are available for academic entrepreneurs who would like to venture into industry, like startups. They do get grants, and then there is a sort of, you know, scale up at the initial stage. But I see a very few examples who are succeeding finally, as opposed to if you compare the examples in West, even in the I would say second class university. I'm not talking about Harvard and MIT. So why is that, and can it change in coming years? Do you have any?
Well, I mean, the US higher education system is a much larger higher education system. And they have a gross enrollment ratio of about 77% or 78%. Our gross enrollment ratio is 26%. They are a much larger ecosystem. The funding is much larger. The amount of money that government or that the Department of Biotechnology spends in 1 year, NIH spends in 3 days. You know, that's the scale we are talking about. But, you know, I really think that we should not worry about those things. We should keep pushing the system. And, you know, good things are happening here. It's not that. I mean, you did talk about startups. Startups are beginning to come up. I mean, 10 years ago, 15 years ago, would you even talk about startups in anything other than IT, right? So all that is happening. I mean, it's very good that ISR Bhopal has an endowment plan, a vision document. That's excellent. That's the way to go. It's not going to be easy extracting money from these fellows, but you must try it, and you must be very strategic in what you are asking people. And therefore, it's very important that you not just have a vision document, but you have people on your board who are able to guide you in this path. It's not everyone's cup of tea. Yeah, but you know, you've made a start. Good luck and well done. There are some questions back there.
Good evening, sir.
Hold it closer.
As far as my question is concerned, you have just touched upon this question. So my question is that much of India's these donations go into these dargahs and mandirs and masjids, of course, everywhere. So even the higher class as well as the middle class spends on these. So what can we do? What steps should we take to divert or pull in a good amount of this into the universities or institutions, because most of this goes in those socio-cultural organizations and there is no transparency as such. So what can we do about this? Thank you.
Well, I mean, as young educated people, you should try and talk to people and convince them. And when you become rich, support universities and don't support religious institutions. That's all I have to say. I really don't know how you will convince somebody. I mean, some people find it very important to give to religious places, and there's nothing wrong with it. It's just that, you know, a college or an or a university, the donation there goes much further. Are you Muslim, by the way? Yes. Okay. So you will understand what I'm about to say. There is something called Sadqa-e-Jariya. You know what is Sadqa-e-Jariya? You make a donation, and the returns of that donation keep giving you, keep washing your sins away for eternity. So when you give money to an institution, when people get educated from that institution, that gets into your account wherever that is. So I think there is a concept of that in every religion. It's just that we are looking at it in a very narrow way and not looking at it very broadly.
Okay, so maybe the last question.
Yeah.
So, is there a misalignment of our...
Hold it closer and speak loudly.
Is there a misalignment with our current education system and the opportunities it offers, given, as the employment is getting more and more market-oriented? Like, is there a need to link this to get our youth employed?
Market forces do play in this, but you know, I think it's, as I said, you know, just market forces alone should not guide you. Educational institutions also train your mind to solve future challenges if they are doing that. And that's important, because, you know, if you know how to solve challenges, you will help the economy back. So I think our policymakers have to be wise enough to invest in education, in R&D. Globally, it's seen that for every 100 rupees that you invest in R&D brings you a return of 20 rupees per year in the long run. Okay? And it's the same with education. Unfortunately, we see this in very short term. Just the other day, in this budget which has come, let's look at the good parts of it. The good thing is that the allocation to all science departments has increased. DBT got an increase of 17%, CSIR got an increase of 10%, DST got an increase of 13 or 14%. It's another matter that DRDO and Department of Atomic Energy and Department of Space got a much larger chunk. On the other hand, 3,000 crores was cut from school education budget. That seems to me to be a very short-sighted policy. You can't be giving more money to do research. I mean, I'm glad they did give more money to do research, but you are cutting away from preparing people to come up and do research, right? But this doesn't make sense. And I'm sure, you know, people who have made these decisions have many other things to look at and to balance. And they have done it after careful consideration. But yes, it, you know, this is a problem. Yeah.
All right. So with this, let's thank Dr. Jamil for this. And now to end this, I request Professor Mukherjee to hand over a memento to Dr. Jamil.